Right. If you have your Bibles with you this morning, I'd ask that you turn to Nehemiah. Nehemiah chapter 9. And we're going to begin reading in the very first verse. Nehemiah chapter 9. The first verse says, "Now, in the 24th day of this month, the children of Israel were assembled with fasting and with sackcloths and earth upon them. And the seed of Israel separated themselves from all the strangers that stood and confessed their sins and the iniquity of their fathers. And they stood up in their place and read in the book of the law of the Lord, their Lord, their God, one-fourth part of the day, and another fourth part they confessed and worshipped the Lord their God. Then stood up upon the stairs of the Levites, Jeshua and Benai and Kadmiel, Shebaniah, Bunai, Shebariah, Benai, and Chenani, and cried with a loud voice unto the Lord their God. Then the Levites, Jehoshua, Kadmiel, Benai, Hashbaniah, Sherebaniah, Hodariah, and Shebaniah, and Pethaniah said, Stand up and bless the Lord your God forever and ever, and blessed be thy glorious name, which is exalted above all blessing and praise. Thou, even thou, art Lord alone. Thou hast made heaven, the heaven of heavens, and all their host, and the earth, and all things that are therein, the seas, and all that is therein. Thou preservest them all, and the host of heaven worshipeth thee." I'd like to preach, the Lord being my helper this morning, on the thought, what are the contents of heaven? Dear Lord, we thank you for your goodness and your watch care. Lord, we praise you for all that you do for us. Lord, we thank you this morning that we have a place out of the elements that we might sit and worship you and study a portion of your word. Lord, we pray that you cause us to crave the things of heaven. Lord, that you cause us to desire to be there more than anything else that this world may have to offer. Lord, we pray this morning that you might save, Lord, that you'd speak life to someone that's lost, Lord, that you'd give them a great victory this morning, they might understand and know that you and you alone are God. We pray these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. Now, Nehemiah, fairly familiar verses of Scripture. It was a day in the revival of Israel. All through the kings, they had kings that would be a good king that would serve the Lord, and then a bad king that would go after the things of this world and go after idolatry, and then another good king would rise up, and they were just back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Now, if you think about that in your own life, that is a picture of you. Back and forth, back and forth, back and forth. Good days for the Lord, bad days for the Lord, back and forth, back and forth. And that is a type of the nation of Israel. Now, notice it says, now in the 20th and 4th day of this month. Now, if you will follow this, that's about the 10th or the 12th day of their revival. If my memory serves me correctly, and that's not always the case, this actually started on the feast day, which is the 14th day of the month. And so they're well into this time, and they had discovered a copy of the scripture down at the temple, and they didn't even really know where it came from. And then the young king began to pray and began to understand the state that Israel was in. Now, we would be well done today if each and every one of us could understand the state we're in. Amen. Not the state of our nation. We know the state of our nation. We understand what it is. We understand what the state of the world is. But what's most important for you is to understand what state you're in. How are you? What is your situation this morning? Now, they understood that, and I want you to see that, first of all, they humbled themselves with fasting. Very, very important. You want power with God? You better fast. You want to be closer to the Lord? You better fast. It's very key. It is a New Testament doctrine as well. Now, the next thing it says, and they were assembled with fasting and with sackcloths. Now, I don't see anywhere in the New Testament where we're commanded to go on with sackcloths. But I will say this, in our own culture even today, and it has slipped in my lifetime considerably. Used to, when you went to the funeral home, everybody dressed in black. It was a type of respect for those that had died. And you were in mourning for that individual. It was black. Now, what they were in mourning for is their lack of connection to the Lord. Now, today, sadly, many times we don't even get a tear down the cheek for it. But they were in sackcloth. The whole nation had rejected God and rejected God in every way. And now we find them in a situation where they were grieving. And then lastly, they had put dirt on themselves. Now, dirt is always a type of sin. And so they were making it very obvious, not only that they were sorry, but they were sorry over their sin. You know, that is really true confession, and that's true repentance when we're willing to do that. You know, a lot of people will say, well, I think Judas was saved. Well, you need your head examined, because first of all, the Bible says he was a devil from the beginning. Yeah. And then secondly, read that part when he went into the temple. It said he repented himself. It didn't say he repented to God. And that's about the most level of repentance I see today. Sorry they got caught. That was Judas' situation. And today, that's kind of what we've arrived at, is that more than being repentant, we're simply upset that this situation was made known. So these people were different than that. They desired to understand God. And the seed of Israel separated themselves from all the strangers. Now that's very important this morning. If you want to meet with God and you want to understand what the contents of heaven may be, you're not going to get that at a distance from God. Now, I fully believe that we can understand some of what heaven has waiting for us here and now, but you're not going to get it while you're mingled up with this world. You're not going to get it attached to idolatry. That's what this was about. Listen, the Bible says in Ezra, very same account of the same events, that they sent away their children that were mixed breed. They sent them on to another place. Right. Listen, I can imagine turning one of my children out, but they so desired the things of God, they did it. And that should be our desire too. Again, how beautiful heaven must be. Yeah, I understand that, but do you really know the content of heaven? Listen, by my understanding of the scripture and study, listen, you won't be hugging mama's neck anymore. You ain't going to be upset. You know what? It's going to be such a sinless place, people that you may have known and loved. But listen, they were God haters. They didn't have the real deal. And they were cast alive in heaven. Not only you're not going to have the boo-hoos over that, you'll rejoice in it. That's heaven. People don't like to think about it like that, do they? But see, you can't imagine total separation from this flesh. But in that place, we'll have it. And so we see that this repentant spirit always brings a glimpse of heaven. Verse 3, and they stood up in their place and read in the book of the law of their God 1/4 part of the day. Now, their day was blocked off into 6 hours. So, there were 2 parts in the daylight and 2 parts at night. That's why they came unto the sea in the fourth watch of the night. That's somewhere between midnight and sunup. That's the fourth part. The first part of the day was from 6 to 12. They had a meeting. They worshiped God. And from that time to dusk, about 6 p.m., that was the second part of the day. And so for a fourth part of that day, 6 hours, they simply read the Word of God. Now, y'all think I'm long-winded. Well, let me get up here one day and preach for 6 hours, and I bet when I get done, I will be preaching to my wife and my daughters, because y'all done got sick of it and went to the house. But listen, they were so desirous of the things of God, they sat there for six. And notice it didn't say they preached. Just read the Word of God. Just read from the books of Moses. All, you know what? In 6 hours, I would bet that they could read the whole thing very closely. And then after that 6 hours, instead of running and getting them a good hot meal, then they began to confess. You know what? To the real believers in Christ, if you're out of the will of God, this will bring repentance. It said for the next 6 hours, meaning from noon to nighttime, that they began to confess what was wrong with their life. Listen, you want power? You want a glimpse of heaven? Confess our sins. You want to know why there's powerlessness in our churches today? Because we don't confess our sin. What does the Bible say in James 3:16, I think it is? Confess your faults one to another and pray ye one for another. You know, I believe our churches are crippled is because of the sin. And listen, you know what? You can go to the Father through the person of Jesus Christ. And I understand that you can get forgiveness. But it doesn't take it away from your responsibility. Our churches are getting powerless. And the only thing that I can come to in that is the very fact that no one is confessing the wrongs that they have done in their life. And then, so in verse 4, the Levitical priest, which was their office to do, it says that they got an arrangement on the stairs, and the pulpit was similar to this, but it was even higher, and the Levitical priests stood on each side, and I think it's 6 in number, and they got in their position. Now, if you want to get a glimpse of heaven this morning, you need to get in your position. Listen, your position is not first dog. It is not chief dog. Your position is just as low as you can get yourself, and this flesh will hate it. It will not enjoy it. You think you're something different than anybody else. Where you need to be is just about as low as you can get. That's the position you need to be in. It's the position I need to be in. And so they went through the Levitical arrangement so that they would be in the right position. And once they got there, notice, they say, stand up and bless the Lord your God forever and ever. And blessed be thy glorious name. They blessed the name of the Lord. They got right and they confessed their sins. And then they began to praise the Lord. You know what? I fully believe this. That if we get to where we need to be, we won't be embarrassed to praise the Lord. You know where embarrassment and shyness comes from? It's not that we're embarrassed that... It's not that we're going to be ashamed. It's something that's between us and God. So we know and He knows it's not genuine to start with. And so if we make that a genuine event, listen, embarrassment will flee away because truthfulness will flow out. And then and only then we'll be able to praise Him unhindered by this flesh. Verse 6. Even thou art Lord alone. Thou hast made heaven the heaven of heavens. Now get that. Thou hast made heaven, that lofty abode of God, the third heaven. Thou hast made heaven the heaven of heavens. In other words, it's the very, very tip top. It's as vast as it can be. You made heaven beyond understanding. You made heaven glorious and great. You made heaven that can...
fathom the imagination you have made a place that we can't even describe. Heaven.
Oh, you know, I don't know that much about it, but I desire to be there. I want to be with it. And he gives little glimpses all along the way of how great and wonderful heaven is. What a marvelous place that he's prepared for us. And listen, all of us would be lying this morning if sometimes we... Listen, if you don't get sick of this place, something's wrong with you. You say, oh, you know, I'll just abide till the Lord comes. I understand that. And I'll even go further. You don't have a choice. You'll have to abide until the Lord gets ready for you. But listen, this is not our home. We are pilgrims, we are strangers, and if you can abide here and enjoy it and have a big belly full of this world, something is wrong. Something is wrong. And so we see then that these individuals had got in mind that they wanted to get a good glimpse of this place called heaven. Go read the book of Psalms, Psalms 11. Now, a lot of times, what I have found in the studies and the sermons I have heard concerning heaven, walls of jasper and gates like pearl. And certainly I believe that that is part of it, but I will say this. A lot of what you read and may attach to heaven is actually the kingdom of God. It is actually the new city, Jerusalem. That is not the third heaven that abides right now. There is a huge difference. So what we're looking at is that lofty place where God abides now. What does he say in Revelation chapter 21? A new heaven and a new earth. That's not what I'm talking about this morning. I'm talking about heaven right now. The present heaven, the third heaven, the abode of God. As we know it, even as we speak this morning, that's where he's at. Psalms 11, verse in the first verse, Psalms 11 in the first verse, a psalm of David, the Bible says, in the Lord put I my trust. How say ye to my soul, flee as a bird to your mountain. Now, I want you to see one thing about this. David's saying, I put my trust in the Lord. How do you say you possibly are going to leave this place? How do you say that I'm going to flee from God? Verse 2, for lo, the wicked bend their bow. They make ready their arrow upon the string, and they may, that they may privately shoot at the upright in heart. If the foundations be destroyed, what can the righteous do? The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. So we get two things there. There's some kind of temple in heaven, is there not? That's just what the scripture just said. There's some kind of temple present there. We've been talking about the wilderness temple a lot in Adam's class. And it just says there's some type of temple there, right? And his throne. Remember in Revelation chapter 4, the Bible says in the cherubims and the seraphims cried, holy, holy, holy. See, that's still going on today. It is still an event that's occurring. You know what? If we said, holy, 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 all the morning long, that is not even a scrape of what's been going on for eternity in that place. We can't comprehend it. We can't get our minds around the idea of what praise will be there. So we find two elements that will be there. The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes behold, his eyelids try the children of men. Now, from the very beginning, there's always been the children of God and the children of men, has there not? And here it says, God, from that place,
tries the children of men.
In other words, he's disgusted by sin.
He tries the children of men.
When he looks down and doesn't see the blood of the Lord Jesus Christ, his anger and his wrath is kindled.
And he understands and knows this.
So we find two elements that are very rarely mentioned in sermons concerning heaven, and that is the throne of God and the temple of God. They're present in heaven even as we speak this morning. And you know what? They ought to create within us a desire to be there, a desire to know that what a wonderful and marvelous thing simply to behold God on His throne. Not about mama, not about daddy, not about the streets of gold, not about the walls of jasper, but simply beholding God in His magnitude. What a wonderful, what a beautiful place heaven must be. See, we really need to get a hold of what it's all about. It goes way beyond many times of what we think. Go with me to Psalm 73, just a little further over. And there's another piece of heaven that's revealed in Scripture, Psalm 73, in verse 25. Psalm 73 and verse 25, the Bible says, "Whom I have in heaven, whom have I in heaven but thee? There is none upon the earth that I desire besides thee." So we have the throne of God, we have the temple, and here David says we have God. Who have I in heaven but thee? Very singular thought. David says, "I have none by thee except thee." Now, if my memory serves me correct, David had some, I think, like 50 wives and several concubines. And see, he put all that aside. It wasn't nothing like his son Solomon, but he had a lot too. And he set all of that aside and said, "Who have I in heaven but thee? I have nobody else." You know what? You think about when the Lord Jesus on the Mount of Transfiguration came down, and there was Elijah and Moses discussing what was going to transpire the next few days. We're not going to be concerned about them. We're not going to be upset about Moses and Elijah. We're not going to want to see what happened to Enoch that walked with God and was not. And the reason we're not going to be interested, it's all about God. It's all about God. And you know what? I think in a moment, all those questions that we may or may not know about will be answered anyway. But here, it's about the Lord God Jehovah. About Him. About who He is. About what he does. That's a wonderful thing about heaven. Now go with me in the Gospel of Matthew. Now while you're turning there to Matthew chapter 13, let me include this concerning heaven. It's not mentioned a great deal in the Old Testament. Most people, when they study heaven, are somewhat surprised to find out that, but literally the hundreds of scriptures that mention heaven in the Old Testament is about the heaven that we can behold, the skies and the outer space, the first heaven and the second heaven. 95% of the scriptures, I even go 99% of the scriptures in the Old Testament just tell us about that. And you know what? In modern science, those are two areas we understand now. But we understand nothing about the abode of God. I have flown literally in different parts of this world. Been all through the first heaven. You know what? That's not a tip of the iceberg. Seen lots of photos and lots of film work from space missions from the beginning of our space program. We know something. I don't think we all know all. We know something of the second heaven, do we not? But we know nothing about the abode of God.
So we see, as we begin to look at this, the Old Testament patriarchs, they understood less than we. That there's very little about the abode of God in the Old Testament, but rather about what can be seen about us. And that's not the portion of heaven we're discussing this morning. Matthew chapter 13, verse 31. Matthew 13 and verse 31, the Bible says, "Another parable will put ye forth unto them, saying, The kingdom of heaven is like a grain of mustard seed, which a man took and sowed in his field, which indeed is the least of all seeds, but when it is grown, it is the greatest among the herbs, and becometh a tree, so the birds of the air come and lodge in the branches thereof." Now, I want you to see in 31, we see something that we really can't get a hold of when he says the kingdom of heaven. Yeah. Because we don't live in a kingdom. We live in a democracy. Praise be God for that. I think it's been sustained for a while longer. But we don't understand a kingship. My sister-in-law is from Scotland. She understands kingdoms better than you and I do. Now, they don't have a true kingdom anymore. They do not have a monarch. Queen Elizabeth does not rule. She's a figurehead. But they esteem her very, very highly. Now, while I don't think that praise should be put toward men, she is having an advantage over us because she understands a kingdom. So we find the next thing about about glory in the third heaven, it is a kingdom. Now a kingdom must have a monarch, one that rules. Everything goes by the touch of his hand. Everything is completed. Everything goes under his authority. That is a kingdom. So when you arrive at the third heaven, you're nothing more than a subject. And you know what? A subject don't even have a vote. You ever think about that? What the king says goes. That's it. Now that's what heaven will be like. And you say, you know what, the flesh rears up, well, that ain't fair. I just don't understand that. Well, yeah, you don't understand it. It's because you've got this flesh to deal with. But you know what? In that place and in that time, you'll be glorious happy to be just simply a subject in the kingdom of God. Just next to nothing in the kingdom of God. And so we find another thing about heaven that most people really don't like to look at is that it is a kingdom. It is one where sovereign rule exists. It is a place where God and God only depicts everything. Nothing gets in his way. Nothing challenges him. Now let me say this, the devil or Satan, Lucifer in his rebellion, he thought he could defy God, but he could not. But you know what? Rebellion doesn't exist in the kingdom. Foul thoughts doesn't exist in the kingdom. He's a king. He's sovereign. He's above all. And so when we get to heaven, we arrive at the third heaven, you will be a subject under the complete authority of the great King, the mighty King, the Lord God Jehovah, and His Son sitting at His right side. Now go with me back a little further in Matthew chapter 5 and verse 12. Matthew 5 in verse 12, the Bible says, "Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. For so persecuted they the prophets which were before you." Now, as the Lord Jesus is giving what is often called the Beatitudes, but really what it is saying is you're blessed, you're blessed, you're blessed, you're blessed. Never one time does it say to be like this. It just said blessed. Blessed, 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 blessed. And when he finishes that, now again, you can look at those verses concerning those who are blessed, and you can evaluate of yourself, are you in that content? Blessed are the pure in heart. Blessed are the merciful, for they shall see mercy. Those blessed individuals, are you in that group? Do you include that? So if you are among that number that do this, and it occurs in your life on a routine basis, then we get to verse 12. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad when they revile you. When they say, that's not true. You are a hater. When you speak out and say, sodomy is a sin. It's a sin that God hates. And they say you're a bigot and you're closed-minded and they're reviling you. He said, in that point, you're blessed. Blessed, blessed, blessed. When you say marriage is from one man to one woman for life, and they revile you, you're to rejoice. Rejoice and be exceedingly glad, for great is your reward in heaven. So we find another element to heaven, and that's a reward. A reward. Now, you can read through there, and if the best I can understand, if you've not been reviled, and you've not been despised, and you've not been run through the wringer for your beliefs, your reward is going to be slim. Because it says, praise the Lord when they revile you. For your reward will be great. So we have to, just common sense would tell you, if you've never been reviled, then your reward's going to be slim. Now, you don't go looking for trouble. But listen, when you stand for the truth and you draw a line, trouble will come find you. Right? And so we see then that when this happens to us, think about the heavenly place, think about the lofty abode of God, and know that there will be a reward for this. It will not go unrecognized by the mighty God of heaven. It will not go. And one day, you better take that and lay it at the feet of Jesus and say, listen, it's all been about you. I've done nothing to deserve this. It's all been for you. There are rewards in heaven. And if there are rewards in heaven, certainly there's going to be some that's flat broke. Matthew chapter 6 and verse 20. But lay up your treasures in heaven, where neither moth nor rust doeth corrupt, and where thieves do not break through and steal. Now we find another element in heaven, and that's treasure. There are treasures, according to this, plural, in heaven. Now that has to be different than a reward because we've read both, right? And treasures in heaven. More than one. Now it says, lay up not treasures here. Now, according to Brother Junior's study this morning, we're talking a little bit about that, the gentleman who built greater barns. But we are not to lay up treasures here. Do we need to be a good steward? Sure. But listen, we need nothing else. If you have an opportunity to genuinely help someone, help them. Be good to them. Give them something. Because you can't take it with you. I often write something on my board, and beginning with my class on the lecture day, it's just one statement. And this week, they said it was discouraging. And I just wrote up there, 6 feet evens up everybody. Because some of those students think they're better than others. But you know what? It's not true. Right? There are treasures in heaven. We need to be compassionate people. We need to be known for how we help others. And especially, the Bible says, especially of those that be of the faith. We need to help them that are people, are our own people, and also help those that out. So we find that there is a temple, there is a throne, God is there, a kingdom is there, a reward is there, and treasures are there. Now, another thing that sometimes we often take for granted, but in the modern day, maybe it is best to remind us, Acts chapter 1 and verse 10. Acts chapter 1 and verse 10. And while they, meaning the 500, and while they looked steadfastly toward heaven, as he went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel, which also said, "Ye men of Galilee, why stand ye gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, which is taken up from you into heaven, shall so come in like manner as ye have seen him go into heaven." So we find two groups of a general group called angels, and some of them abide even in heaven now. We've heard of Michael, the archangel, right? Unless God is sending him on dispatch, he's there this morning. We read of two groups, and you could say three groups, the cherubims and the seraphims. Remember, in Isaiah had his vision in Isaiah chapter 6, he saw the seraphims crying, "Holy, holy, holy," back and forth, one to another. I would cry it out, and Eric would cry it back out at me if we stood in that office again and again and again, crying holy, giving him worship, giving him praise, giving him honor. And then we find the third group, which was the one Lucifer took with him, said that with his tail he brought a third of them with him. And listen, that's an innumerable host. We have no idea. I know of Legion, there were at least some 2,000 cast out of Legion alone. That would be enough to make the hair stand on the back of your neck. I mean, that amount of evil and hate. And that is just one individual. And so we find then that these innumerable hosts, we can't imagine how many's there, and yet and still rejoice in heart, because the Bible says two things that always come to my mind when I think of angelic beings, and the first one is this: ye have entertained angels unaware. And we have no idea who that is. I will say this, if you see them on a routine basis, such as a church, they're probably not angels. Because you have to be unaware of them. You don't even have to know who they are. I bump into them. Entertain angels unaware. And also, Bible says, your angel. You know what? I fully believe that we all have an angel. They're dispatched to us. They watch over us. And so we find that even in that innumerable amount, God is compassionate enough and good to us to have our own angel to bed, you know, to protect us and to provide for our needs. And so we find then that in that place, that lofty place in heaven, that angels will be there, be part of it. Ephesians chapter 3, Paul's letter to the church of Ephesus. This was a church that needed some clarifications on some things. It was a church that was discouraged. Ephesians chapter 3 and verse 15, the Bible says, "Of whom the whole family of the earth is named." We'll read verse 14. "For this cause I bow my knees into the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, of whom the whole family of in heaven and earth is named." Now, did you get that? In heaven, there's a whole family that will be there, of whom the whole family in heaven and in earth is named. In other words, they're named after the Lord Jesus Christ. That group in heaven, and even the group that still remains here, they're named after Christ. What does the Bible say concerning the Antioch church? And they were first called Christians at Antioch. Now, nothing wrong with being called a Baptist. Kind of shows what we believe. But first we desire to be called a Christian. You know, there's groups out there, such as the First Christian Church, that's tried to pull that name away from us. There's nothing wrong with that name. It's a good name. It means you act like Christ. It means you present like Christ. Nothing wrong with that. And so we see that another thing that will be in glory is a family. That's why we're instructed to call one another brothers and sisters in Christ, because it's a family there. It's a group there. It is our people to be in glory in heaven. Last thing, if you will, turn with me to 1 John. 1 John chapter 5. 1 John chapter 5 and verse 17. 1 John 5 and verse 17, the Bible says, all unrighteousness is sin. All unrighteousness is sin. All unrighteousness is sin, and there is a sin that is not unto death. We know that whatsoever is born of God sinneth not, but that is begotten of God keepeth himself, and the wicked one toucheth him not. Now, I want you to see that in verses 17 and 18, we read of what will put you there. In other words, what takes you to glory? What puts you in the place is your knowledge of God. Your knowledge that you've been born again. Not simply knowing of a man named Jesus. Not simply knowing of a person named Christ. But knowing Him intimately. Knowing that He spoke life to you. Knowing that you're close to Him. When you think of heaven, what do you think about? Are we so petty that we think of a mansion? I fully believe that John described it the way he knew to describe it. Do I think there's mansions there? Yeah, probably. You think I'm going to be excited about them? With the full person of Christ sitting before me, I don't think I'm going to worry that much about it. See, the all embodiment of Christ is what our concern is. And today we get so many foolish things going in our mind.
Yeah.
You know what? As much as I love my mother, as much as I love my wife and my daughters, nothing's like the love of Christ. And all they that will be there will be a wonderful family. But my attention, for finally and for once, will be on God the Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. And why would I want to interrupt you for that? The only thing that I would desire to do is have something to lay at His feet and say, thank you, Lord Jesus, because I do know this, according to the Bible, there will be some saved so as by fire. In other words, saved and gloriously saved, but that's it. Never spoken the word of Christ. And you know what? I have to believe this. And I believe there's some people saved on a deathbed. I understand that. I think there are a lot fewer than we'd like to believe. I do believe that. But listen, I think the majority of these people will be people that sit in Baptist churches. Saved for years. And years and years. And saved so as by fire, because they were fearful to do one thing for the cause of Christ. Pretty sad, ain't it? I want to worship Him, don't you? I want to see some of the glories that we discussed this morning.